Hi, I got several emails and some comments about the D750 recall or extension of the second recall announced recently. With questions, should I send it back or should I ignore this, and with an overall negative attitude about this whole thing. And this is visible, this attitude, all over the internet. I think, in the contrary, that this is an awesome news. So in the next couple of minutes, I'll tell you how it looks like from a camera repair tech point of view, why it's awesome, and the most important thing, I'll give you several essential tips about how to go through this whole process quickly and as painlessly as possible. Hi, I'm Mike, independent camera repair technician, and I'm starting fixyourcamera.org to show you the photo gear industry from a different point of view. No specs, no marketing BS. Talking about things you won't hear anywhere else. Welcome. Quick disclaimer here, I'm an independent camera repair tech, I don't work for any camera manufacturer, I don't do any recalls or warranty repairs. See, these toys are extremely complex. If you include all the electronic parts, there are thousands of parts inside. I bet you already know that. Also, there are lots of people involved in the process. And they do make mistakes. Sometimes totally stupid mistakes. And so does Nikon and all other manufacturers on this planet. And don't think that I'm trying to defend Nikon here. I'm very far from that. On my list of favorite manufacturers, Nikon is somewhere at the very bottom right now. It's a long story why, so I'll tell you some other time. But in short, lack of replacement parts. They won't sell them to you. Repair prices. Waiting times. Customer support. The whole grey market issue, where the customer is punished instead of the distributor. Way too many problems with their products in the recent years. Questionable quality control. Plus several others. And the big one. D600. In my opinion, that camera, coupled with Nikon's behavior, was a complete and utter disaster. There were several problems with it, and Nikon kept refusing it over and over and issuing statements about natural dust accumulation. So it ended up as a several class action lawsuits, settlements, and a big dent in the company's reputation. So that's about the corporate part of this company and their decisions that I don't like. There is, however, the other part of Nikon. And these are the people responsible for design, engineering, research, firmware, and many other things. They truly have some world-class talent there. Some Nikon products are absolutely brilliant. You just cannot deny that. And many people love them, including me. So yes, I'm super happy to see a recall after recall and then an extension of a recall, because this means that maybe, finally, something has changed at Nikon. See, a manufacturer that recognizes problems with their products quickly and is willing to fix those problems right away is a good one. Canon, for example, is good at this. Not perfect, but good. With Nikon, it used to be more like hiding behind the closet doors and pretending that nothing has happened. And the customer would get a response like, "This is the first time we hear about this problem. This is not included under the warranty." Or, "We can check it for you, please send it to us." And then he gets his camera back in the same condition. There are lots of stories about this all over the internet, and it's exactly what my customers kept telling me over the recent years. So, there is hope. If they recognize problems and are willing to fix them, which, by the way, costs them a lot of money, they will most likely pay a lot more attention to quality control. Maybe, someday, they will also realize that it's not such a great idea to punish the customer who bought a grey market camera, often completely unknowingly. Or maybe they'll notice some of their customers walking around with their products with a big piece of silver duct tape right under the Nikon logo, just because that cheap plastic front cover that cracks easily used to cost anywhere between 15 and 40 bucks, and it takes 8 to 12 screws and a couple of minutes of time to get it replaced, now is not available. And Nikon tries to charge a couple hundred bucks for this repair, plus shipping and insurance at the post office, of course. I won't go that far with my hopes for now, but in the future, who knows? Question: should I send my D750 out and get this repair done? My answer is definitely yes. Several reasons. 1. Additional potential problems. Possibly, There are already some service notes for D750. A service note basically says to the repair tech something along the lines, if you have this product in for repair, every single time do also this and this and check for that. And these are usually some minor issues, not publicly available. Or there could be some additional important issues with this camera that they just don't advertise in the service advisory. And it makes a perfect sense for the manufacturer to get them all corrected at the same time. I think that was the case with Canon 5D Mark III. The problem stated was a light leak, and from what I could see while working on them later, was that these cameras were disassembled much further than it would otherwise be necessary to correct a light leak issue from the top LCD. So, very likely that there were some additional problems corrected at the same time. 2. All recalls or service advisories usually have some time limit. It's typically a long time. But if you realize after a couple of years that the problem bothers you, i.e. the flare issue or the shutter sink, as in this case, you might have to pay for it, and it will be expensive. 3. Resale value. While selling your camera sometime in the future, the buyer might know about this issue and will ask you about it. So if you don't do it now, you might have to sell your camera for less money in the future. Question: can I ignore this recall and just move on? Sure, if you want to, no problem. Okay, now how to go through this whole process as quickly and as painlessly as possible. You've been using your camera for some time, most likely, and you already know if it has any additional problems. If so, it might be a good idea to put a note together with your camera. Make sure your description makes the problem a no-brainer. Even for someone in the shipping department who has no clue about cameras. For example, D750 service advisory plus intermittent power switch problem. And they will direct it to the correct place right away. Most likely some other people are doing the service advisory work, i.e. subcontractors. By the way, the industry rumor is that these two addresses on East and West Coast are just PO boxes and most repairs go to subcontractors. I don't know if it's true, and either way, it really doesn't make that much of a difference to the end customer. As long as they do a quality job, of course. The people who will work on your camera will have lots of cameras to do and very little time to spend on each one. While I'm sure that Nikon's step-by-step procedure for this advisory is gonna be very thorough and include everything that's necessary to make your camera work perfectly, don't forget that people are doing this job and mistakes can happen. Also, they might forget to run some time-consuming adjustments. Some subcontractors are probably a bit more prone to this than others. Of course, take it as an industry rumor, the official version is that everything goes always perfectly. So after you get your camera back, check if it works. Don't put it into a drawer for 3 months to remove it a couple of hours before an important event. There is no need to go nuts with a microscope about this checking. Just test if it works. The focusing, most functions, just use it. Shipping. How to avoid problems here. You will most likely get a UPS label from Nikon. Use a quality box, not some spaghetti noodles packaging type. Remove completely all accessories, lenses, memory cards, straps, put a body cap on. You can put your camera into a nice, clean, sealed bag. Some of the packaging material is very dusty, and you don't want this dust to get inside of your camera. Next, since this is a rather expensive $1,500 to $2,000 camera, I would also take pictures of it before packaging, then inside the box showing how it's packed, and then after you close the box and put the label on. Make sure that these pictures are of good enough quality so that they can be used as a proof in case of any problems. For example, the serial number is easily visible, the label text is easily readable. With any shipping problems, when the packaging gets lost or there is some damage to it, you might have to answer a lot of questions. If you have those pictures, they cut the discussion before it even starts. There is no doubt that all the packaging was excellent quality, there was way more padding around your camera than necessary, the label was secured perfectly to the box, and it takes maybe 1 minute total for you to make those pictures. Last important thing about shipping. If you hand this package to the driver, you won't get any confirmation. So it's a good idea to go to UPS store or UPS shipping center and ask for a drop-off receipt or scan confirmation, whatever they call it. And the lady behind the desk will hand it to you in about 2 seconds. This way you'll have additional proof that you did actually drop off this package at this specific location and time. It could also be very useful in case of any problems. And of course, follow Nikon's shipping instructions. I'm sure they will give you some. Okay, so overall, there is no need to complain about this whole thing. Yes, it's a bit of trouble. Yes, it might take some time. But also notice that Nikon this time, let me repeat that, this time is willing to spend a significant amount of money to get your camera working perfectly. Nobody's pushing them to do it. There is no class action lawsuit. And they do the right thing. I'm very happy to see that. Okay, I hope this information helps you feel a bit better and avoid some possible problems when shipping out your camera. See you next time, probably in some teardown and review.